Here's a couple of interesting stats I picked up the other day. 50% of global energy consumption is actually heat. 3/4 of the world's heat generation comes, unsurprisingly, from fossil fuels. Industrial heat represents an operating cost of more than $300 billion a year for manufacturers just for the fuel, plus another $30 billion in equipment. And industrial energy consumption is projected to increase by 50% by 2050. Those are really not particularly encouraging numbers at all. So we need some robust solutions to be put in place very quickly indeed. Here's one of them. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. So what we've got for you this week, folks, is a German company called Kraftblock. And what they've developed is a thermal energy storage system that could help create a circular economy between industrial heat producers, power companies, small businesses, and even district heating systems. Now, we have, of course, looked at several other thermal energy storage technologies in the past. So what's different about this one then? Well, I'm glad you asked, because that was exactly what I was wondering. And to get some answers, I had a chat over Zoom recently with the inventor of the system and co-founder of the company, Martin Schichtel. Martin explained how the design of the system was born out of a comprehensive research program to identify and assess more than 500 different material candidates. One of the key priorities for the company was to optimize sustainability, not just of the material they ended up choosing, but of the entire storage system and the applications it had serviced. That pretty much discounted synthetic materials like magnesia bricks or alumina bricks, both of which are used today as liners for blast furnaces. They can handle some serious heat, no doubt about that, but they're also very energy intensive to manufacture in the first place. Martin and his team then considered more nature-based materials like sand and gravel, and even volcanic rock and magnetite. Again, all materials that are either in development as thermal energy storage media, or in some cases already in use, as we've seen in several previous videos on the channel. But all of them need to be mined and processed, which of course requires a bunch of energy and produces plenty of greenhouse gas emissions. Then there's always good old concrete, of course. I think we all know how environmentally friendly that stuff is, don't we? So that was a no as well. So instead, Kraftblock focused on materials that are currently considered to be little more than costly and inconvenient waste products in industry and construction. During the course of their useful life cycles, many of those materials have already been exposed to very high temperatures, either when they were made or as part of their functional operation. But once they've served their useful purpose, they mostly just get discarded. The prime example, at least from Kraftblock's point of view, was the steel slag that comes out of the bottom of a blast furnace during the process of converting iron ore into steel. Now, you don't need me to point out that we humans have been producing steel for all sorts of useful things for many decades now, and the steel slag at production plants around the world has been steadily building up into what could now be described as a collection of small mountain ranges. So there's plenty of it, and for operators, it's something they would be delighted to get off their hands. It's a material that's already coped with 1400 degrees Celsius in the blast furnace, and it is literally just lying around all over the planet, just waiting to be scooped up. It's as cheap as chips to buy, and of course it represents an opportunity to create one of those nice circular economies, where we humans engage our brains a bit more effectively so that we can start making good use of the things that we find, a bit like the Wombles. And if you're from outside the United Kingdom, you'll just have to Google that one. So anyway, we've established the material of choice. The next challenge is to develop a configuration and operational procedure that optimizes the properties of that material for the most effective storage and release of heat. To get that bit right, Martin explained that you have to consider a material's heat capacity and its conductivity. A big solid lump of something like a ceramic material would have a very large capacity for storing heat, but really poor conductivity. In other words, it takes ages for it to get up to temperature, and it also takes a long time for that heat to be released. Also, you may only manage to heat up 50 or 60% of the storage medium itself, leaving the bit in the middle relatively cool. Essentially, that's just a waste of space. That may not be a huge problem in certain applications, and there are some great thermal energy storage systems out there right now that work perfectly well that way. But for a more flexible and responsive system, you really need a much higher surface area to absorb and release heat quickly. That generally means a container full of small particles instead of one big lump. But you also want to retain as much heat storage capacity as well, for obvious reasons. The solution that Kraftblock has developed is to use a fine powder of the waste steel slag material and combine it with a phosphate-based binder already in use in many heat-sensitive industrial processes. Every grain of steel slag powder is encased in a carefully calculated thickness of the binder and then fabricated into a pellet or a honeycomb shape or whatever is the best option for the given application. The pellets have a massive surface area of between 3 and 4,000 square meters per cubic meter. That provides an enormous heat storage capacity. Then the phosphate binder essentially provides a sort of transport grid to facilitate the very fast movement of heat directly into the heart of the storage material. The result is a storage medium with very nearly 100% energy storage efficiency and virtually none of the wasteful internal temperature gradient that you get with a big solid block. And the really smart piece of insight here, what you might call Kraftblock's USP, is that they can tailor the ratio of storage medium to binder extremely precisely depending on the customer's specific needs. So for example, if you have an application that needs a switching time of 10 seconds, then you can add more binder to give a faster route out for the energy. Or if you need long-term storage of maybe a couple of weeks, then the mix is less binder and more powder, which maximizes the storage capacity. According to Martin, that means an almost infinite range of tweaking that can go on to get just the right ratio for the application. All of that clever stuff is done right at the beginning of the production process as a bespoke recipe for each customer. Then it's just a question of feeding hot air through the system to charge it up and cold air back through it again to push the heat out when it's required. The hot air can come from all sorts of different sources. It could simply be produced by a resistance heater driven by excess energy from renewables like wind and solar, or it could be the waste heat I talked about earlier from industrial processes. The Kraftblock storage system itself is basically an extremely well-insulated box housed inside a shipping container, effectively creating a modular Lego-like system that can be as large or as small as the customer needs it to be. That obviously offers a good level of flexibility on site, and to be honest, it's a pretty standard industry template that we've already seen in most of the other thermal energy storage solutions that we've looked at over the years. What's not so standard though is the concept of using that shipping container for its original purpose, which is to facilitate the most efficient movement of products from A to B. What if that product being shipped was literally a box full of 1300 degrees Celsius of heat, effectively offering a mobile delivery system? Think of it as the Uber Eats of heat delivery. Maybe they could call it Uber Heat. No? All right, well, why would a system like that be useful then? Well, lots of industrial processes do have their own heat recovery systems to improve the overall efficiency of their operations, but many don't. The US Department of Energy estimates that between 20 and 50% of industrial energy input is lost as waste heat in the form of hot exhaust gases or cooling water, and heat lost from hot equipment surfaces and heated products. It'd be great if you could simply install a network of pipes to pump all that heat to somewhere useful, like a district heating system, for example. But heavy industry is rarely located right next to urban conurbations for obvious reasons. So that kind of infrastructure would in most cases be prohibitively expensive to build out. And that's where mobile heat might just fill a useful little gap. Moving heat from place to place has apparently been tried before, but only for low grade heat systems of between 80 and 100 degrees Celsius using hot water or low-grade waste heat that can provide perhaps 1 megawatt hour of energy. The difficulty those previous systems faced was that by the time all the costs of transportation were factored in, most of the benefits had been negated. Kraftblock's system stores heat at more than 1300 degrees Celsius, as I mentioned earlier, and at that temperature, you're talking about well over 10 megawatt hours worth of energy in a 20-foot container, and the economic numbers start to make an awful lot more sense. By decoupling energy generation from energy usage, not only in time, but also in geographic location, an industrial manufacturer could potentially save themselves the cost of installing an expensive heat recovery system and instead generate extra revenue by selling their waste heat to a third party like a district heating network or any number of other low-grade heat consumers like a bakery, for example, or perhaps a small brewery that needs a bit of steam. An important point here is that just because the heat is stored at 1300 degrees Celsius doesn't mean it has to be discharged at 1300 degrees. The discharge temperature can be fully controlled simply by altering the speed at which cold air is trickled back through the storage medium. So one of these containers could theoretically be delivered to a small enterprise on a Monday morning and provide 100 degrees Celsius of heat for an entire week or so. Obviously, Brian and Colin in accounts would have to crunch the numbers, and it won't be the right solution in every situation, but it will certainly make sense for some operators. And to that end, it represents a smart solution that I think would have put a smile on the face of my lateral thinking hero, Edward de Bono. Craftblock has got a couple of pilot projects already on the go, but perhaps their most significant partnership is with one of the world's largest snack food producers, PepsiCo, in their production plant at a typically unpronounceable location in the Netherlands. The project will move the factory from natural gas to renewable electricity to provide heat to fry their range of Lay's crisps or potato chips. That transition will reduce the facility's carbon footprint by 8,500 tons of carbon dioxide every year. The lifespan of the Craftblock storage unit is at least 15,000 cycles, which equates to more than 40 years based on a daily charge and discharge. Phase one of the project is scheduled for completion in the autumn of 2024, and if the mighty PepsiCo are happy with the results, then they've said they'll commit to additional Craftblock units that could see them achieve a 98% reduction in overall emissions from the plant. So there we are then, folks. No doubt you've got your own views on solutions like these, and maybe even your own direct experience of working with them that you can share with us all. If you do, then as usual, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. Thanks as always to our fantastic Patreon supporters who keep all these videos independent and completely free of ads and sponsorship messages. If you find the content useful and informative and you feel like you could support my weekly work here on the channel, then why not pop over to patreon.com/justeverthink to have a look at the exclusive benefits you can enjoy there. And of course, you can hugely support us right here on YouTube, absolutely for free, by subscribing and hitting the like button. Won't cost you a penny to do that. It's just a simple mouse click away, either down there or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.